What's wrong with the criminal justice system in Harris County? 30 seconds or less.
The lack of humanity in the judicial process.
What's wrong with the criminal justice system in Harris County, in your opinion?
I think what we have is, the dockets are so crowded it becomes more of a processing mill than actual disposition of cases based on the law. Basically, the way I see it is that if you don't want to contest it too hard, you want to accept responsibility, you can go through it and you'll come out with a pretty fair sentence. But if you're a person that actually wants to assert your innocence and go to trial, it'll take you a long time, it'll be very inconvenient, and it's very costly. The system is very good for, it's very well designed for those who are guilty and want to process through the system, but it's not that well designed for someone who actually wants to contest their innocence. It's just a long, prolonged, costly situation. And I think there's also a problem in terms of the DA's office is too much in control of the judiciary, in my opinion. It's too closely aligned. And there's no real judicial, as hard as the judges try, and we have very good judges, but it's the politics of the situation, the dominance of the DA's office, and we have a system that is pretty much, it's not really independent. It's a very pro-state and it's very political and it's very hard to get something that's objective, in my opinion. Though we have very competent judges and they try to do the best, but that's a problem.
Well, first of all, it's elitist, it's racist, it's sexist, and it's not what citizens think. Okay. Of when they think of the criminal justice system, it's very difficult for anyone who's poor to prevail in a system like this. So many people in this state plead guilty because they don't have the education, the means, or the resources to fight their cases. Consequently, there's a whole population that becomes disenfranchised more or less through default and not understanding this system. So there's a lot wrong with it.
The courts are busy, and the problem is that there's a lot of cases filed that shouldn't be filed. Particularly right now, the cases that I'm referring to are the family law type charges. A lot of those cases are filed with police officers, and they use what they call a zero tolerance. In other words, if they're called to come out, they're going to arrest somebody to carry them to jail, and you know who that's going to be. It's going to be the husband. You come down here, yeah,
cases.
Family violence. And the DA has a policy that they normally don't dismiss those, and they really don't try to negotiate them, and they really don't try to recognize the problems in their cases. So ultimately, those type of cases go to trial.
Yes.
And now I'd estimate that probably 6 to 8% of the cases now are being handled by the county courts, and probably 5% of the district court of family violence cases.
The biggest problem I think we have with the justice system in Harris County is twofold. We have overzealous judges who tend to feel that punitive actions at an early stage of a case is somehow better for the justice system, like revoking bonds when the defendant hadn't done anything wrong just because they can raise it.
Right.
You've got some prosecutors who feel the same thing, closing files for no reason, seeking to revoke bonds for really no reason at all, and forcing the defendants in a position where they can't really defend themselves.
Right.
That's why I see it.
Well, as a former prosecutor, under Johnny Holmes, it seems like things have changed now. See, I think as criminal defense lawyers, a lot of times people think we represent the crooks. Well, now under Rosenthal, you've got prosecutors acting like the crooks. They're running around breaking all the rules and doing whatever they can just to win. and that's just wrong.
Every new judge seems to be coming out of the district attorney's office, and there's no real change.
The prosecution sometimes is overzealous. The police department is overzealous. Look at last weekend's newspaper, you'll see that the police department, one officer made $172,000 on DWI cases. They arrest everybody that's even remotely connected. They call other officers in when they don't need to be.
You can't get in without a badge and waiting in a really long line.
That's part of it. All right, now give us your serious answer.
I think we need more diversity on the bench. Would be a great help. I think education for the public in a number of areas would be a good help. There are a lot of things that are on our dockets that clog up our system that I think we could certainly deal with in a better fashion. Less than a gram dope cases are an excellent example of that.
Okay. What education for the public?
Well, I think if the general public knew how much time, money, and effort was spent on, just as an example, less than a gram dope cases, for the lack of return on their money, I would say, I think that they would definitely be on board with a better solution to that. I think those could be handled in misdemeanor court and be more effective.
It's so fast. It's so I say fast. It's like a cattle call. We have some in our county, small county, but the defendants are just moved through, and I'll see how a defendant can feel like they're getting justice because it's such a cattle call situation. I've had difficulty contacting the local prosecutors to get results about my client's situation. Little communication between the probation department and the prosecutor in this matter. I feel like a month is plenty enough time to get an answer to a couple of questions I had, and that I still couldn't get today.
Do you think you're being obstructed?
No, I don't. I just think it's just the sheer volume. I have tens of thousands of defendants, and it's proving difficult for it to work.
I think one of the main problems is that the sense of fairness and justice in this county is skewed.
What do you mean?
The district attorney's office thinks that they're being fair when they offer your innocent client a long deferred on the fifth jury trial setting. Innocent people get offered deferred probation here. Well, I heard a judge say to me one time while he was picking a jury, if it feels morally wrong, it's probably illegal. And in essence, what we've done is legislated ourselves that everything's illegal at this point. You lose sight of really taking advantage of prosecuting bad people for bad crimes. You're prosecuting everybody for just about anything. It's out of hand.
You know, stuff like, you know, conspiracy, and with the Patriot Act saying that if you're a member of an organization and any member of that organization commits any act that endangers, you know, life, then you're labeled a terrorist. And
well,
I mean, it's arguable that okay, you're a member of the Republican Party, let's say.
Gotcha.
And, you know, someone from the Republican Party goes and breaks into the Watergate. Well, are you a terrorist under that statute?
Certainly, you could be tried as one.
My name's Grant Hardaway, and I think the system...
How long have you practiced, Grant?
34 years.
What do you think's wrong with the criminal justice system?
I think the system now is just totally unaware, totally tuned out to the defendant and to their needs. And they try to do absolutely nothing to make the system work for the defendant as well as society, just for the establishment, basically, I guess. Best way to put it.
And can I ask you this? Do you think racism is still inherent in our system here?
Well, you know, I've been doing this for such a long period of time. Certainly it is. Certainly it is. How do you get around that? Yeah, sure it is.
Part of society.
Yeah. Yeah, sure it is. And that's sad, but it is there, yeah.
The problem with the criminal justice system is that we have prosecutors that don't honestly review their cases and dismiss those that need to be dismissed, that can't be proven. We have judges that bow down to prosecutors and have no respect for equal treatment of the participants at trial. And we have defense attorneys that need to stand up and fight vigorously and not themselves bow down to prosecutors and judges. That's what's wrong with our system.
I think part of the problem is the numbers game that's played by the district attorney's office and by the court, wherein their most important thing is to move their docket as if there's not going to be any more cases ever filed. And I think that's a huge problem.
As a former prosecutor, I believe there's no real justice and there's no empathy. I mean, it says Harris County Justice, Criminal Justice Center, and I kind of chuckle because justice is a joke. It's just a matter of convict and get the maximum amount of time in jail. I just think it's wrong.
Sharita, what's wrong with the criminal justice system in Harris County, in your opinion?
The prosecutors don't switch fast enough. They have been, they're unsuccessful in trying to work with people. They don't even attempt to work with you anymore. They've set standards and office policies which are ridiculous. And I think a lot of the things around here need to be changed, including some of the judges.
Right, the criminal justice system in Harris County has a fundamental flaw right now that exists with the belief of a win-at-any-cost mentality. There is a, because it's an adversarial system, we all want to win. The problem is that if you have one side that inherently has more power than the other, and they have a win-at-any-cost attitude, it creates an imbalance.
Which side is that, Wendell?
The district attorney's office, because they are more powerful. If they developed a win-at-any-cost attitude, it puts a defendant in a position to where injustice occurs. People aren't as concerned as much about the right result coming out as they are of winning the case. And although the system's set up that way, it doesn't work when you have one side with more power than the other.
Well, in my opinion, there's really no sense of presumption of innocence, and it's pretty biased, in my opinion.
Okay. You think people are presumed guilty in Harris County?
Definitely.
I think, we're out of tune with the district attorney's office and the reality of what goes on the street. And the street, from my perspective, includes the individuals that suffer from a real type of illness, and that's mental illness. I think decisions are made based to a great degree on by the district attorney's office on a total lack of understanding about the realities of mental illness, the mindset of individuals that are mentally ill, and decisions that are made by people that are truly psychotic. Psychotic is a reality that is unique to the person that's suffering from that illness. And to prosecute, to include jailing and the threats of penitentiary and death row, individuals who are not capable of making a decision that conforms with the Webster's definition of what, for instance, to know right from wrong means is back in the dark ages, and I just hope that with the stuff that the Harris County Criminal Lawyers Association is doing, that it sheds a great deal of light of intelligence on the actions of our prosecutors.
One serious problem that has been outlined by the Bromwich report is the number of cases in the crime lab that need investigating, need lawyers, that need just experts to re-examine the problem. And the fact that some of these cases, even death penalty cases, were not examined by the district attorney's office in their independent review. We don't know how many people did not get fair trials because of the Houston Police Department crime lab.
Can the results from the Houston Police Department crime lab be trusted?
From what we've seen for the period of time that's been under review, no. There's an inherent problem that innocent people have been convicted, and no one knows how many. No one knows the extent of the problem, or how many people are affected. And we don't have money for lawyers or experts.
And has the district attorney's office been very cooperative in this matter?
I don't think it's been forthcoming. I don't think they've been very candid, and I don't think that they've effectively investigated their own shop.
the double standard. What applies to prosecutors doesn't apply to defense lawyers or defendants. When the government does it, it's good science. When the defense does it, it's just trying to get somebody off. What's good for one ought to be good for the other, and we ought not be accepting things as good science and reliable simply because it's the government doing it. And until we stop doing that, we're going to get unreliable science. Everybody wonders why the crime lab fiasco can happen the way it does. The reason it can happen and the reason it will continue to happen is because neither prosecutors, judges, nor defense lawyers will make the effort, will take the time to not just guess it right, but ensure that it's right. And everybody screams, oh my God, we've got a problem when it happens, but nobody's willing to take the time to do it right in the first place, and that's all the way down the line. The prosecutors simply put it on because they don't know any better, and that's all they've got. Sometimes they do know better and don't care, but for the most part, they just don't know any better. The judges don't, many of them don't have the time, don't want to take the time, don't want to learn this stuff. They didn't become judges to go learn science, and that's the attitude. Defense lawyers are the same way. They didn't become lawyers to learn all this science, so they just kind of let it slide or take cases they're not qualified for. And in the process, the system breaks down and we get injustices. We get crime lab fiascos because there's not been enough caring on any of the sides involved in the process.
Well, the trouble of it is that the people that are involved in the system don't know what the problems are with the system because they function by rote action. The prosecutors are all of one mindset and they don't know what their oath of office is. They just mouth it and they don't know that it's their responsibility to see justice done. Otherwise, they wouldn't prepare witnesses to lie so well and they wouldn't accept the fact that most officers lie under oath. And the judges know what's going on because before they were judges, they were prosecutors, and so they know how the system works so well. And it's this business of resignation. Nobody has any respect for the principles that were laid out whenever the nation was founded about equal justice under the law and protection of those who are most vulnerable, the poor and the intimidated and the uneducated. Those principles are very much a part of our history, but they're not a very large part of our present. Criminal defense lawyers, I think, sometimes try, but a lot of them are ex-prosecutors, and they accept a bunch of givens that rest of the system function on. So they're looking the other way as they go through the motions. And poor people, and people of color, and people whose English is not so good, and people of questionable document status are just cannon fodder for a system that doesn't realize how far it is off the mark that was intended for them to be.
If you are a member of a group and any member of that group commits any act that endangers someone.
Well, in Texas, the law of parties means that you don't even have to be there. If you can be associated with somebody else that did something, you can be suckered in to be a defendant on it. Now, generally, those people get off lightly, but lightly in the case of an unintentional murder during the commission of another crime could be life in prison for somebody who didn't know it was going down, was not present when it came down. But that's all under the law of parties. Texas has had the principle of including everybody in on every conspiracy for a long, long time. I mean, you just take the numbers. There are 2.2 million people locked up in prison in the United States tonight, and another 2.8 million people locked up in city and county jails tonight. So we've got 5 million people locked up tonight in jails and prisons in the United States. That's the largest percentage of any nation's population in the history of the world. Now, have people got so significantly worse during the last generation that resulted in those numbers? And if you believe what you see on television, they've got another 13 million people who happen to walk across an arbitrary line without documentation that they would like to lock up. But since all of those jails and prisons are already at capacity, the other day they locked up 72 in one raid, but they let 59 of them go because there just simply was no room at the end. And So they missed out on all the virgin births. I don't know how that happens, but the rhetoric of who we want to lock out up is beyond physical possibility to lock them up. But the whole nation just doesn't seem to understand that all of this talk of locking people up is not a natural and normal thing to do. They believe that we've got so many people locked up, we got so used to locking people up, that we think it's all right to just lock everybody up. It's fine. And just go through the motions and pretend that they've had due process, that they've been adequately represented, or they've been given the options that free people should be given in a free society.
There's been this enormous power shift from the judiciary to the prosecutor. And,
you know, the shift of power from the judiciary to the prosecutor may be true on a national level, and it may be true in other areas of the country, but there is no line in Harris County between the judiciary and the prosecutor, because the prosecutor's office is where you go to become a judge. All criminal judges in Harris County have been prosecutors and were chosen by the district attorneys of Harris County's control of the Republican primary to fill that position. And the minute they cross them, then the district attorney comes up with an opponent that defeats them in the next Republican primary. And of course, in Harris County, all judges save two or three justices of the peace are Republicans. Let me say that there's some heroic things being done by a handful of courageous criminal defense lawyers. And in order for them to do courageous things, they have to spend a lot of time keeping up with the law and reading new cases and the follow-up of new cases. But not only can everybody be made into a criminal at the arbitrary decision of the prosecutors, and then the judges rubber stamp that, but anyone accused of a crime is not given the presumption of innocence, because after all, we're dealing with prosecutors and we're dealing with prosecutor judges. So there is no presumption of innocence. So nobody bats an eye when a judge says, oh, you've been accused of a crime, so I'm going to put you on a monitor so that you can't leave your house pre-trial. In our society, our country, what our society was built to be, we were supposed to have the presumption of innocence. That was a principle built in. We were supposed to have fair and speedy trials. That right was built in. We were supposed to have due process. Those rights were built in. We were supposed to be free of unreasonable searches and seizures. That's supposed to be built in. We were supposed to be protected from the power of the high sheriff, with the independence of the justices of the peace. And the grand jury duty was supposed to allow citizens to overlook the beginning of the whole process. None of that works as it was written to work. It's all become a fixed game and a done deal.
Talk for a second about why. Do you think public relations theory, do you think that we've just become a nation that's been brainwashed by mass media? Or, I mean, I know there was this urban legend that criminals were getting off on technicalities. Mm-hmm. And, I mean, you know, there's this Dirty Harry thing.
Like having completed their time and other technicalities. A technicality is somewhere their rights violations were so blatantly beyond the normal rate of rights violation that they were entitled to relief. Or somewhere their sentences, according to the laws at the time they were sentenced, would be ameliorated by good time laws. All of that was being released on a technicality. And those technicalities were just mundane parts of the law, which have now been largely undermined in a dramatic thing. And I don't think media brainwashes us so much as it inoculates us, so that when truth and criticism of the system appears, we've been so inoculated by this den of really being bombarded by so much media that we don't feel the pain of the loss of our rights.
Do you think America's going to survive, or are we going to end up in a, I mean, are we in a police state already? Or?
1605, November the 7th, the gunpowder plot and treason was uncovered in England. They made a recent movie about it. It's called V for Vendetta. We need a Guy Fawkes in America in the worst way. We need a John Galt, a real one in America, not fictional characters, but real ones. Somebody that calls us back to our roots, especially in criminal justice. The farce of criminal justice is that the tree doesn't have any roots. It doesn't even go all the way to the ground. It begins on a pack of old truths that have become new lies. And the presumption is that we can never get back to the principle. There are, I believe, a significant number of us in this society that believe that we not only can get back to the principle, but we believe we must get back to the principle. Is it going to take a revolution for that to happen? Maybe. But probably not a revolution that people think about as revolutions, but it's going to take a movement of people getting tired of believing the lies. Truth and the value of truth would save us if we begin a movement in time with a serious enough objective.
Well, that's the guy.
We're going to make a few statements for the media on this disgusting day in Houston history.
Right? I'm old enough to have remembered when there was a courthouse behind this tree, and me and Raymond, my father, would come downtown, and it was just an old crumbling relic of a courthouse. And they tore it down to build the Albert Thomas Convention Center, but before they did, it became a good metaphor of our criminal justice system. It's crumbling because it has not changed. And the reason it has not changed is that Texas is a very conservative society. Just earlier this week, the European Union asked the governor of the state of Texas to call a moratorium on executions. And what he said was that 200 years ago we struggled out of the oppression of Europe, and we came here of our independence, and Texans a long time ago decided that executions was a just and fair punishment for the worst crimes. I would like to ask you, those words were by Bob Black, spokesperson from the governor, but he's got a confusion of spokespersons. Kathy Walt, who used to be a credible reporter with the Houston Chronicle, became his spokesperson and brought him to power. Now Bob Brown's there. I want to know what Rick Perry, Bob Brown, and Kathy Walt know about oppression. Those people don't know anything about the heavy weight of oppression. I'll tell you who knows about the heavy weight of oppression. Black, Hispanic, and poor white people in Texas who are subject to stand in line to be executed on Texas death row. Is it not oppression to kill 400 of your citizens in rapid succession? Is that not oppression? Is not the fear of that oppression? I want to know what Governor and his rich friends think about using the term oppression when all they're doing is wallowing in the arrogance of their power and their wealth. Yes. They have no idea the lives that I live below the poverty line, or in Jerry lives, or Esther lives, or hardworking teacher Gloria lives. They don't have a hint about that. All they know is their privilege and the arrogance of their power. Do those people actually speak for a significantly number of people that live in this state? If so, where are those people today? Well, some of them are working for TYC, abusing the children, and involved in a cover-up operated by the state so that the Republican candidate contributing people who got powers of political patronage don't go to jail like anyone else who does the same thing. The arrogance of their power has a stench to it, and I hope anyone who hears these words help spread that word. Thank you, Gloria.
All right, I'd like to introduce Jerry Shakur, who's a longtime abolitionist, who has visited death row for many, many years, who has lost a loved one to the executioner. Jerry.
We are out here today because of the outrage of not only Kenneth Foster being sentenced and probably about to die for a crime that he's totally innocent. It's cause for outrage. When we think that 400 human beings have been executed, it's cause for outrage that our society still is so barbaric, that it is still so imbued with racism and classism. I've visited death row for over 10 years, and I've seen families unite with people in the visiting room, and I've seen them fall away when their loved ones have died. It is a racist, anti-poor agenda that thinking and caring people have to work against. And we stand here under this hanging tree to say, no more death.
No more death and no more legal lynchings. This year on October 27th, the 8th Annual March to Stop Executions is going to take place in Houston. I'd like to introduce Esther King, who's one of the organizers for this march.
You know, of the 400 people who've been executed, quite a few of them came from Harris County. Harris County is the place where the crime lab that gathers and analyzes evidence has a national reputation about like a fly-by-night used car lot. And for the citizens of Houston to sit quietly by, and you know, silence can be construed as consent, while this county sends people to death row with court-appointed attorneys that are least qualified, least compensated on matters of life and death. I, for one, will not sit quietly by while these things are done in my name. There was a time when the method for execution was a group of good old boys with some liquor, some ropes, some guns, some kerosene, who would elect a candidate for capital punishment that they administered while the legal authorities looked on and would have a spectacle of entertainment. That was capital punishment. The state stepped in with the same methods, but they've done it over the years behind closed doors so that we would be sheltered from what was being done in our names. And finally, I want to say that on the moratorium march in October, 27th of October, Houston, we have to let the politicians know that we don't agree with the state of affairs. We have to let them know that's the only way they're going to get involved to change the laws. That's the only way. When they look up and they see hundreds and thousands of people expressing outrage at the state of affairs in this county and in this city, I'm calling on all of the friends I've made over the last 40 years on these picket lines. We have to put this question on our radar screen. We have to make this issue an issue of importance. We, NAACP, come on. The Urban League, come on. National Black United Front, come on. We have to do that, because if we can stop the death machine, it'll be much easier to stop the railroading of all of our young people into the public and private prisons that are being built for them as I speak.
Anything I can do for you, for Lee?
You know, I talked to one of the ladies here about the sticks. I haven't talked to Ms. Rubeck about it. I was going to talk to her.
Yeah, I talked to her about it. I didn't.
Oh, okay.
It's about time participation, and we're fixing to leave, so that'll set a pace. And when one wanders off, the rest of them begin to look for those. There's nobody here that I don't know.
Yeah.
There ain't no danger. Good to see you.
Who is that gentleman we just saw?
I don't know his name, but he is assigned to this demonstration by the criminal intelligence captain to come and see that everything goes all right. And I really feel sorry for him, because there wasn't nobody there except a bunch of professionals, so he didn't have anything to do. And so there toward the end, he said, well, I guess I could ask him some questions about the sticks on their signs. And so he came over to try to justify the time card he's going to put in, because it's overtime for him. And so he's going to have to justify that. But his predecessor was a fellow by the name of Gene Kennedy. And Gene's assignment at one point was to watch after Ray Hill. And so Gene would call me with some emergency in his voice and say, can you fax over your calendar for the last 2 weeks so that I can fill out my report? And so I would fax him my calendar, and he'd look very good, because he had kept up with me and all these obscure things that nobody else would have noticed. Now, when it come time to select an officer to decide which crimes were hate crimes against the gay and lesbian community or the black community or any other minority, and which were not, I was in a big meeting with all these honcho police, and they said, well, who are we going to get to do that? That's an awful lot of responsibility. And I said, well, Gene Kennedy, of course. Because I knew that Gene Kennedy would try very hard to determine what was a regular robbery and what was a robbery motivated by prejudice. And he did that. And when he retired, I said, Gene, you did that job well. He said, that wasn't near as much fun as keeping up with you. I actually had to work for a living my last few years on the department.
But what's been going on in the adult non-SOB video business? His officers have been coming in and telling employees, get yourself an SOB manager's license. Well, the business is not an SOB. I don't care. If you don't have a manager's license, by the time I get back here next Monday, you're going to jail. Well, Captain and I have had a couple conversations about that. Well, the problem with that is that nobody was willing to try a case. Well, voila, we finally got a case. We got the worst judge they got, Janice Law. I mean, Janice Law is not your ordinary liberal. She's a tough lady, but she does read the law. And so we go there with the defendant, the lawyers on both sides, they even pick a jury. And then the judge looks at the file and says, well, why isn't the business registered as an SOB? And the prosecutor says, well, the business is not an SOB. So Judge Law calls the jury in, orders them to find the defendant not guilty, and they're out of there. Well, that left one more concern, and that is the officers who walk in the store and tell the clerks in a non-SOB that they're operating an arcade that makes them an SOB, and they're going to go to jail for that. We've got one of those cases, no arcade permit. And guess who we got for judge? Janice Law. I was beginning to think, what is running out? Janice Law looked at it and said, wait a minute, the arcade ordinance is part of the SOB ordinance. So you start at the top of the page, and if it's not an SOB, the arcade ordinance does not apply. She ordered that jury in, she found the guy not guilty and dismissed the case. It's time for the threats and the bullying to pull up. Now, three other officers had gone into a non-SOB adult video on Hempstead Road. Gave orders to the employees. It's an affidavit from the guy that was a clerk. It's there. And commandeered part of the building to hold their arrested suspects. Now, I'm not a constitutional lawyer, but that, and the Third Amendment, you don't hear it very often, but it's about soldiers taking over people's property for government purposes without any due process. Nobody asked the owners or the managers of the store if they could use part of that store to hold prisoners. And they didn't arrest all those prisoners. They arrested all the prisoners, didn't take them all in. They cut some of them loose after holding them on that man's property in a separate quarters. It's only in the affidavit. One more point, because I'm accusing these officers of basically being bullies, going around, going beyond the law, pushing people around and enjoying it. And I'm a gay guy, so I know all about bullies. I've been living with bullies all my life.
Let me ask Dave or Jerry to respond about this bullying thing, what he was talking about.
I agree with him. I think, and you know, I've talked to my officer about it, I don't know that it's a thing they intend to do. It may be something that they walk in, they automatically make the assumption that this is an SOB. You're working an SOB, you better get your license. Well, that puts the store owner, the manager, in a predicament, because now he goes out and gets an SOB license. And later when we come back in and close down the store for having no SOB license, what some people may do, I think we've done it, but some people may go in and say, well, yes, you are an SOB. No, I'm not an SOB. How come this manager over here has a license? Mm-hmm. Well, we got it because you told us to get the license. Well, you didn't have to get it. Well, you told me if I didn't get the license, I'm going to jail. So it's
okay, let's go back for just a second. Who determines whether it's an SOB or not?
It's actually, we have to do an undercover investigation on it. We make an arrest for it being an SOB without an SOB permit, and a judge would be the one who would determine is that an SOB or is it not.
No, that's not what I'm talking about.
Here's what the statute says.
Yes. See, I'm talking about...
Here's what the statute says.
If I wanted to go out today and open up me a business, I don't want to get arrested first. I want to know, how is it determined whether what I'm going to do today is an SOB or not?
That's kind of a gray area, because what it says is if 51% or more of your primary business is the sale of sexually oriented material, then you are in fact an SOB. Now, if you talk to other people, they'll say, no, it's 51% or more of the stuff you have on display. You talk to another person, say, no, it's 51% of your business revenue.
Let me do this. Because I have read the statute. Statute just says primary business. Mm-hmm. What your primary business is. During the Judge Atlas hearing, your predecessor, Chandler, was on the stand along with Fallis, and both of them testified to the judge that the standard is the inventory. If over half of your inventory is adult in nature, and that is your primary business, and that is a matter of your department's testimony to the federal judge who wrote the decision quoting your department's standards in the decision holding the ordinance constitutional, and he said, as long as the standard is. He said, if you change the standard to how much money is going through the cash register or some other standard, then it becomes, he said, she said, they said. But if it is strictly on the basis of the inventory available for sale, then that is a clear standard and that is constitutional. That's what, quote, the federal judge in the SOB ordinance. The officers have come in and they have told various clerks various things, like we heard just here, about what is, you know, what is primary business and what that means. But in my mind, according to the ordinance and according to the federal decision that upheld the constitutionality of the ordinance, there's not any gray area.
I think clearly there's a need to clarify some issues, some procedures, understanding of what the law is, it sounds like, in one particular area, and make certain that the vice officers understand themselves what is an SOB and what's not an SOB, what the guidelines are. I'm not talking about the officers wanting to make a case to prove that it should be an SOB. That shouldn't be the test. The test should be an examination of the court's opinion or the black letter law. And the officers have guidelines up front. Go into place. If this exists, then it is an SOB or it's not an SOB. Because I don't think the officers ought to go in telling people to get an SOB license if they walk in and see that this place is operating in an area across the line whereas it should be in possession of an SOB license, they ought to take action. They ought to just take action. Otherwise, leave the person alone and let the person do, you know, whatever business that they're doing as long as it's a lawful and legal business out there.
I know we've kept you too long, Chief. I appreciate your listening. But Captain Cutler's got a few things to think about and work out. And I'm taking it longer than you can. Thank you very much. It's nice meeting you.
We truly appreciate you coming down, you know, laying out some of the issues and allow us to resolve them at this level. Because I think once we get the policy practices and procedures ironed out, it's better for the officers, it's better for the business owners out there, it's better for the customers, and it's better for our city because it saves resources, keeping us out of court when there's not a need to go to court and spend money on the city side, on a business owner side, to get a judge to tell us, well, this is what the law is. But that doesn't make a lot of sense, particularly if you can look at the law and see clearly what it is. And as officers sworn to uphold the law, we ought to do just that.
Ms. McNeil.
If we could go ahead and call the next item.
Mr. Kevin Maddox. Mr. Maddox. To be followed by Ms. Janice O'Neill.
Good morning. My name is Kevin Maddox, and I've been a producer with Houston Media Source for 3 years.
I produce inspirational programs for several churches that normally do not have the resources to take on such a task. Our association with Houston Media Source has allowed these churches an opportunity to expand their ministries as well as their memberships as a direct result of the broadcasts that air on Houston Media Source. Members of Macedonia Worship Center, where the pastor is Walter Pope, as well as Reverend A.L. Hickman of New Commandment Christian Fellowship, have vowed to continue to support Houston Media Source and everything they do throughout the community, as well as myself. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Chair recognizes Councilmember Ellis.
Sir, I didn't catch your name.
Kevin Maddox, M-A-D-D-O-X.
Thank you for coming down today. And you were with what church did you say?
Macedonia Worship Center.
Okay. And what type of programming do y'all put forward on the Media Source channel?
Well, I produce sermons, and also we've done like a variety show, you know, with a little gospel feel to it as well.
You know, I just want to tell you that I'm honored and proud to have your shows on Media Source.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The chair recognizes Councilmember Weissman.
Thank you. Thank you for coming down to speak, Mr. Maddox.
Yes.
So you provide programming that is inspirational, religious programming.
Yes.
And you made a comment that you would continue to support Houston Media Source.
Yes.
In everything that they do. Do you support the violation of federal laws, of city laws, and of contractual agreements that state obscenity will not be aired on this channel?
Well, as to my knowledge, I know we are protected by the, you know, First Amendment free speech.
But this is not part of the protected free speech. It's very clear in federal statutes, the U.S. Code. It's very clear in the fact sheet that the FCC puts out that obscenity is against the law. It is not protected speech on our broadcast airwaves. And it's also reiterated in our code of ordinances. So our statutes are very consistent. The contracts that we sign with the cable franchise companies, the contracts state they cannot air obscenity. So again, we have consistency. The very agreement that Houston Media Source has signed, saying they will abide to that agreement says no obscenity. So my question is, what is it that people do not understand? It is not permitted, and it is a violation of the law. Do you support violating the law?
No, I don't support violating the law, but don't let one incident reflect on the entire...
And that is what I would say to you. It's unfortunate that Houston Media Source would jeopardize the opportunity that you have to air such programming simply because they refuse to abide by every law and everything that they have agreed to abide by themselves. So I would ask you to share with Houston Media Source, who I understand you pay to have your programming on there. You pay them for that programming. Am I correct?
No, I don't pay them. I pay for membership.
You pay for membership, but
that's it. And then I produce my own programs.
And the members, without the membership, you can't air the programming. So obviously you are paying. So as a member, I would urge you to tell them that you don't want that opportunity jeopardized, that you want them to abide by the law and abide by their written agreement.
We'll take that. Okay.
Thank you.
Chair recognizes Councilmember Kwan.
Thank you, Mayor. Mr. Maddox, thanks again for coming down. Let me ask you, before you became a producer, did you have to go through an orientation program with Houston Media Source?
Yes, it's required that you do go through an orientation program before you even become a member of Houston Media Source.
Were you advised of any regulations dealing with obscenity or any content as far as that would be inappropriate?
Well, when we submit programs, we have to sign a contract, and then on the contract you sign and you submit the programs that you have, and then on the back of that it says if there are going to be anything that is, you know, considered offensive, then you have to check that.
Okay. And so do you have anybody at Houston Media Source who checks to verify that you don't do anything offensive? I mean, I don't know.
Well, you may have to check with the programming director of Houston Media Source.
The programming director would be there? Okay. So you do a religious program.
Yes.
Is that correct? Do they ever edit or monitor your religious program as to how you believe in God or what you say?
Not in regards to editing?
Yes.
No, it's like I said, we're protecting, you know, it's free speech. So whatever we put on, you know, that basically airs. And for my programs that I put on, you know, I try to make sure that, you know, it is quality programming.
So you yourself try to make sure it's quality program. You go through an orientation. You sign an agreement with Houston Media Source. They have a director or producer who also verifies that the programming meets those standards and goes from there.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you for coming down and sharing that information.
Welcome.
Thank you, sir, for being with us today. Appreciate that. Next speaker.
Ms. Janice McNeil. Ms. McNeil does not appear to be present. The next speaker is Ms. Mamie Nadawa Masua. Mr. Roy Cross will be followed by Mr. James Moore.
Hello, my name is Roy Cross. I have a video show called Cypher Session. I play music videos and do interviews with local and major artists. I've been a member of the Houston Media Source since about 99. I started when I was in college at University of Nebraska Lincoln. Me and a friend were sitting around and we was watching the TV and we said, you know, it'd be cool to have a video show. So I was like, I don't think that could happen. He was like, yeah, you know, we can make that happen. So he went down to the Access Channel and found out how we could make that happen. We took the classes, we paid our money, and we started the video show up. And that was then, this is now. And because of that video show, I've had a lot of opportunities. Recently, I was flown out to Hollywood, California. I got a chance to cover an artist when he was making his album with the Neptunes. I got a chance to meet Dr. Dre. Jimmy Iovine, the head of Interscope Records. I also had, as of lately, had an opportunity to interview Wendy Williams and Bow Wow. I covered the Bad Boy vs. Rap-A-Lot charity basketball game. Mayor Bill White was there with Sheila Jackson Lee. They gave P. Diddy the humanitarian award. And all that was possible because I had my television show on the Access Channel. And when I meet people, they always ask me, well, how did you get a TV show? How are you able to do all this? And I told them, well, you know, I went down there, I took the classes, and I told them how to do that. And that was the spark that started it all for a lot of people, their curiosity. And from there, you know, when I'm at the actual facilities, I see kids and on up to college students and people of different nationalities and races taking classes and touring the facilities. And that's a good thing. And it's an even a better thing after they do all that and they say, well, hey, I want to do my own TV show. I want to do my own short film and put it on the Access Channel. And they're able to do that. And that's, I say that's a good thing because that gives a voice and representation to the people. And I feel like that's necessary, and that's what the Access Channel is all about. And it's changed my life, and I feel like it could change other people's lives. And I also understand that certain people look at the Access Channel the way that they look at it, and I feel like it shouldn't be condemned and shut down because of the actions of a few producers with questionable programming. I just feel like it could be, you know, just to be fair about it. It's not all about, you can't take that small percentage that have that questionable programming and let it cast a bad shadow on the other producers that take it more serious. And that's what I wanted to say.
Thank you, Mr. Cross. Councilmember Kwan.
Thank you, Mayor Pro Tem. Mr. Cross, let me ask you, you do videos, you say, music videos?
Yes, sir.
And some of them get kind of racy, don't they? Kind of sexually provocative?
A lot of the videos, not a lot, but depending on them, they're suggestive. They are, very. But I know the Access Channel has a real strong policy. I work closely with Eric, and it's always, if you have something questionable, you're responsible for it, and you must sign off on it, and it's aired at a particular time of night. Most of the times after 2 a.m.
Okay. What time does your show
air? My show comes on from anywhere to 12 to 2 p.m. depending on the content of the show. Like if I have a video where it's a lot of suggestion, I'll you know, just play it safe. And it might just be one video out of a 2-hour show, or our show might 3-4 minute clip, but I'll have it played after 2 a.m.
And that's just kind of a gentleman's agreement, or is that a policy of the
That's a policy of the media source. Like I said, I've been with them since 99, and it's always been understood that, you know, if you're going to have that kind of content, be responsible for it, and at the same time, let them know, and they schedule it accordingly.
So there's good communication and monitoring by Houston Media Source with the producers?
Yes, very much so, because if it's not the access channel as far as the people there that work there that catch it, it's always a viewer. A viewer will call in with a comment, and they will give you a call, and I've had friends that have gotten suspended and weren't allowed to do their show anymore.
So people called you complaining about your program at different times?
No, I get a lot of good comments. People email me, and they want to know, like, how can they get a show on there, and actually trying to give some acknowledgement of their neighborhood or whatnot or something like that.
So have there been times when you've had questions about the video you were going to run it, and the person from Houston Media Source said, you know, Roy, I'd rather you not run that, and you said, okay, I'll back off.
That's a touchy subject. I talk about that with my mom. And it's one of those things where, you know, if I feel like it's just really just no point to it, I won't. Like, if it's just too over the top and it just really is no purpose to it, I won't play it. But if it's a nice song and the video is a nice video, I'm not finna play anything that's trashy and it's garbage. But there's some video producers that really do real nice work as far as the video imaging and the way they put the videos together, even though it's a little suggestive. But
okay, all right. Thank you for sharing your
experience. Councilmember Wiseman.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Cross, for coming out here. You made a comment that Houston Media Source, that they monitor carefully. I would like to say that it's unfortunate that Pat Garlinghouse is not here herself to speak before council and address that issue, because she has made it clear through the media that she does not preview, review, monitor a single tape. Her position is anything that wants to be put on there will be put on, regardless of content. And that is what she has stated publicly through the media. And as I said, it's unfortunate that she's not here to share with this council what that exactly is. What is required by the contractual obligation, which she signed, is that obscenity will not be aired. And based on what I viewed and based on the calls I've been getting from people who have watched Media Source accidentally, as I did, that they have seen material that is prohibited by law. By the way, I have caught your show, and with respect to the production quality, I agree, it's very good production work, and as far as the content, you know, some I like, some I don't, but that's totally different. What I like and don't like is different from what's legally allowable and what's prohibited by law. Do you support the violation of the law?
Basically, I can't speak for Pat, but I know Eric is usually the person that I turn my tapes into, and that's who I was understood that reviews the tapes. And at the same time, I just joined the Dallas Community Television, and I know up there they have this obscenity law, and how they enforce theirs is a little different than the Houston Media Source. But at the same time, I've always understood that Houston Media Source, profane language was, you know, all right, but you just, you know, nothing real sexual and graphic is allowed, you know.
Actually, their proposal that they put forth says they will show sexually explicit material during the evening hours. But we pay for this programming because the city made that a requirement with the cable companies, through the franchise. It is not a mandate by the federal government. We don't have to provide that channel. And that channel is paid for by the subscribers. We are forced to pay for it. And we shouldn't be forced to have obscene material force its way into our home. And after we have been forced to pay for it. Are you at all concerned that for someone would take such great risk to jeopardize the opportunity that you've had by violating the law?
And see, that would be the thing that I feel like those producers should be dealt with individually, because it's understood when you turn this program in, what it is, and you made it. And, and when you're making this, you got an idea of your boundaries.
Right, and I can appreciate that the producers are responsible, but ultimately there needs to be some oversight, some management, some responsibility taken by the people. In fact, it's stated in our code of ordinances that the PEG channel programmer, in this case, Houston Media Source, is responsible for certifying that the PEG channel programming does not contain, and I quote, obscene or indecent material or material that is otherwise prescribed by law. They cannot air that. So it is their responsibility. So I would urge you to let Houston Media Source know that you don't want your opportunities jeopardized in that manner.
That's fair.
The bell has rung. I'm going to recognize Councilmember Goldberg.
Thank you. Thank you for coming, and I just want to take this opportunity to remind everyone that Monday, July 11th at 1:30, the Executive Director of Media Source, Pat Garlinghouse, has agreed to come to the City Council Committee. We'll have a meeting and discuss all these issues with her. Also, the Chairman of the Board of Directors of Media Source, Garth Jewett, also will be here Monday at 1:30, and I invite all council members who have this issue, but that's the time they've agreed to be here. I think other members of the board who City Council votes on will also be here to answer questions and probably be able to espouse an opinion with more information. Thank you.
Well, the council member yell for a second.
Yes.
At that committee meeting, would you provide us, the contract for Media Source, what they have to sign off, and I suspect they sign it with the city in agreement. And then also I'd like to look at the restrictions that are put forth on the municipal channel and the educational channel as well, and see the different type of restrictions and guidelines that the four different municipal channels have to follow.
Okay, yeah, I think the legal department will join us also and provide those documents.
Thank you.
Councilmember Edwards.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Cross, for coming down. Mr. Cross, when I joined, it was Access Houston, and we were in the first producers class that went through, friends and myself. Do they still do that class when you come in and you want to have your show? Do you still go through that class?
Yes, ma'am. They still do the orientation class.
When you say orientation, can you give me an idea?
Orientation is
we had to learn the technical camera use as well as production and storyboard and all that. Do they still do that?
Yes, ma'am. It's basically everything starts in the orientation. The moment you walk in, you sign your papers, you pay your money, you take the orientation class. From there, they explain the rules and how the facility works, the whole operation, and then from there, it's your decision, depending on your show and what direction you're trying to go, what classes you may take and what you want to do. You don't have to take a camera class if you mm-hmm. already know how to take, but if you want to use their equipment,
you
anything within that facility, as far as the editing bays or the cameras, you have to take the class in order to have access to that.
Regardless of whatever, if you're going to use the equipment that's there, you have to take the classes.
Yes, you have to take the classes.
Now, there's been discussion of whether or not shows are reviewed for content. Are you saying to us that your shows are reviewed for content, and based on the content, it determines when your show's going to be ran?
From my understanding, I turn my tapes in, and they're reviewed. You have you turn a tape in, you have about 9 days mm-hmm. before it can actually air, and it's to my understanding within that 9 days, that's when it's reviewed and looked at. And at the same time, like I said, on the paperwork, you sign off on the back, and if you check the boxes that says I have explicit material or sexual, mm-hmm. you know, that's notifying them ahead of time. Hey, this program right here is tagged, and it definitely cannot be aired before a certain time. Has to be aired after a certain time.
If it's aired at all.
Exactly. If it's aired at all, exactly.
Is there any discussion as a producer once you start producing your own videos and so forth? Do you have to ever go back and be evaluated? Do they ever come back and say, you know, Mr. Cross, you've ran a lot of these things, we don't like this, or we hope that could you change this? Do you ever have those kinds of evaluation?
Basically, every year you have to renew your membership. Right. And I personally, you know, my show's not that raw where it's off, you know, where it's like that, but I would assume at that time where you have to get, your membership renewed, that's when they would talk to you. Mm-hmm. And like I said, I've had friends in the past that have had their shows canceled and been on suspension. So they will notify you, like, right there on the spot that it's not going to happen anymore.
The reason I ask that, because when we were producing, there were, I know of two shows that were taken off the air. I mean, they literally pulled the plug mm-hmm. during the show while it was on. Mm-hmm. And so I just wanted to make sure that they were still doing some. Is Mr. Hamilton still there with?
I'm not familiar okay. with him, Mr. Hamilton. Right,
thank you very much.
Councilmember Lawrence.
Thank you, Mayor Pro Tem. I'm concerned and interested in the classes that you're given before you start producing. Is there ever any stipulations placed on what you can produce, certain hours, and what you can't? And if there is, could you talk about the programming that's allowed, let's say, after 10:30 or in that time?
Basically, it's to my understanding, if you have that type of program, they usually ask you what type of program you're going to try to
okay,
produce.
Now, right there, the type, the word type, what do you mean by type?
Talk show, religious, you know, oriented, community-based, political, you know, video montage. You know, some people have strictly shows where they don't play videos. It's just live-type music. Things of that
nature. Is there a place on the application that where you might check if there's certain type of language being used?
Yeah, there's a sheet on the you mean on the application? Yeah, they have boxes checked for everything as far as the content is what's on the yeah.
okay.
on the show. So that's definitely on there.
Okay. Councilmember Goldberg, if when you have your committee meeting and you can get some information on maybe regulations at that early hour in the morning with cable television, what's required, I think that would help a lot of us out. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, Mr. James Moore, thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Moore will be followed by Mr. Darrell Douglas.
Esteemed council members, I've been a viewer of Houston Media Source for 6 years now. I was an apprentice for 8 months. In 2004, I was awarded a Programming Excellence Award. I was also co-creator of the show Newscast 17, which is a weekly live news show about local issues. So I feel like I'm somewhat of a source of information for Houston Media Source Matters, and I feel very passionately about this issue. Now, the first program I saw on Houston Media Source was a show called Pack Rat. Now, it showed late at night, middle of the morning. It included nudity and copyright infringement. Now, I haven't seen the show very much since then. Mostly now I watch The Real Deal, Politics The Real Deal, which is a weekly live politics show, Reasonable Doubt, and also one of my recent favorites is Mary Jane Hancock's Entertainment Law show. These programs I just mentioned are 100% locally produced by Houstonians for Houstonians. Less than 1% of the programming is what I think Councilmember Wiseman would consider obscene. Most of the programming is educational, religious, political, or cultural. Christians, Jews, Muslims, Hare Krishnas are all welcome. Anyone can get a program, and there is no review of programming before it goes on the air. That's a fallacy, and I'd like to clear that up. Houston Media Source is a free and open forum for free speech and for the people of Houston. The delay in funding brought about by Councilmember Wiseman is an attempt to curry favor with conservative constituents, and Councilmember Segula Gibbs has also jumped on that bandwagon, and I applaud the members of the council who have not jumped along and gone along with this witch hunt. I hope the mayor and other council members recognize that this is a pitiful display as a political dog and pony show, not a serious matter for the city council. The questions that Councilmember Wiseman has posed today clearly shows that she does not understand the law in these matters. The FCC has guidelines for broadcast over the airwaves, not for cable shows. The restrictions are not the same. And if you watch cable shows on Comedy Central or other programming, there is obscene content, or what some people call obscene. Personally, I think that this whole matter is pretty obscene. And the more important issue here right now is the future of free speech in the United States of America. Every day, the staff of Houston Media Source are fighting for the rights of every citizen in Houston. They educate people, young and old, in ways to speak out on television, and they give them a forum to do it, completely free of any oversight or censorship. And I applaud Executive Director Garlinghouse for her efforts in this matter and her speeches in the media confirming that this is an open forum. And yet, Houston Media Source has been underfunded by the cable companies of Houston. The one channel in Houston where citizens have a free voice is Houston Media Source, but they do not have enough cameras for the producers. There are too many video editors and not enough equipment. There's simply not enough funding.
Thank you. Your time has expired.
Before I recognize council members, the chair is going to enforce the 5-minute rule. Just to remind my colleagues, we do have 5 minutes collectively during public speaking. We have about 17 other speakers on this subject, so I would ask my colleagues, when you engage in Q&A, to please be mindful that we do have your other colleagues that want to ask questions. So if the 5 minutes goes up, I'm going to defer your Q&A to the next speaker. Councilmember Wiseman.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Moore, for coming down here and exercising your free speech right to address City Council. That is your right. Of course, we do have limitations with that right of yours. There are limitations on free speech right, and the FCC and the U.S. Code, if I may be permitted to educate you a little bit, states very clearly what is permitted and what is not permitted. This is not a political dog and pony show. If you are familiar with how this issue even came about, we are being asked as a body to take action. Take action, that means vote yes or no on an item. The item has to do with Houston Media Source. We are the ones who are making that a requirement in our franchise agreement. And federal law does not mandate that we have an access channel. That is the choice that this body has made. So we have made that choice. However, federal law also calls for abiding by the federal law, which states, and I believe U.S. Code chapter 47, I believe, is where you can find it, where it prescribes the laws for public access channels. They're called PEG channels, Public Educational and Government Access Channel Programming. Our City Code of Ordinances also says so. The very contract that Ms. Garlinghouse signed says so. And thank you for bringing to our attention, for clarifying what was misrepresented, that she does not screen anything. Nothing is screened. Free of oversight, as you put it. Free of oversight is not permitted with this programming. It is not permitted under federal code. It is not permitted under city council rules. It's not permitted under a state code. It's not permitted under the very contract that is signed. And I would expect that people who sign contracts would live by that contract. That is supposed to be their word.
I sign a contract every time I produce a show.
Excuse me,
sir,
just a moment.
I have the floor.
Finish your statement.
It is very clear in the Code of Ordinance whose responsibility it is to make sure that the law is being adhered to. You may sign something with them, but it is not their right to pass along that obligation to someone else. They cannot pass it along. It is their responsibility. And that is why this is no dog and pony show. It's not politicizing. I'm doing my job. And my job is to vote on these items. And when I'm going to vote on these items, I'm going to do my homework. And my homework includes making sure that the contractual obligations that we sign and another party signs are lived up to. And yes, I happen to watch that programming. And I've heard from a lot of people who have stumbled upon it too. We pay for that with our franchise fees that we pay to our cable programmers. Nobody has the right. You may have a right to speak, but you do not have a right to force garbage into my home and force me to pay for it. It's clear and simple. So I still have the floor. Thank you for bringing your position to my attention, but let me tell you, we have a responsibility here, and I am living up to it. I work day and night making sure that I fulfill my obligations here. I don't get much sleep, and that's how I stumbled upon this programming. And I will say that I will get some sleep when my work is done. Thank you.
Councilmember Khan.
Thank you, Mayor Pro Tem. Sir, when you do the programming, does anybody define for you what is obscene, what is not allowed? What is offensive? What is violating the free speech laws?
As far as I'm aware, the federal laws on obscenity are very vague for a reason. It's a matter for the courts to decide. And since we're talking about laws here, this is not a matter for the city council. It's a matter for the courts.
Okay, because if you all do, please let me know, because there are many things which are offensive to me. And many of them are not played at after midnight. Many of them are they use very polite words, but they're very offensive to me. But do you think I have a right to not allow that?
I don't think anybody has a right to, I guess, be subjective in what is allowed to be spoken in a free speech forum.
And do you take the First Amendment free speech provisions important? Are they important to us as a society?
I think they're incredibly important, and I am very thankful that most of the city council, I believe, do not feel that or do not take those freedoms so lightly.
And lastly, what I would Council Member Goldberg suggested that before we do any curtail any program, we need to watch it. I don't know whether he intends to play those offensive, quote-unquote offensive programs in front of the City Council, but I don't want to watch it. I'm not sleepless at night, so I don't need to be offended by them. But if it is, then according to the law, I need to know where the law is and where are the limitations where we can exercise any kind of restrictions on what is played on
those. Public funding.
Thank you,
is
sir. I apologize. The bell has rung. I am going to enforce the 5-minute rule. Councilmember Edwards, I apologize. You will be the first speaker on the next one.
Okay, Mr. Darrell Douglas, to be followed by Mr. Robert Zipp.
Good morning, members of City Council. Do I have the floor? Just want to make sure I don't want to get bit out here. I'm 18 years old, and I'm a longtime viewer of Houston Media Source Television. I was born in 1986, and as far as what I know, Houston Media Source was made in 1986. And I enjoy the call-in shows and a lot of the different shows that come on Houston Media Source. Every now and then, I'll flip the channel, and I'll get to Houston Media Source, and I may see something that I may think is weird. But who am I to say what is weird, what is obscene, and what isn't? The different programs that I've seen on Houston Media Source are so, you know, well put together, some of them are not. But the whole point is it's a huge eclectic, like a bowl of culture that we're given. And to come in on what was said about, you know, forcing garbage into our homes, they have an invention for that. It's called a remote control. And if you're ever watching something that you don't like, you change the channel with the push of a button. As far as things being obscene, I have watched Houston Media Source overnight at times. Yes, I have seen some things that some people may call obscene. But who are we to say what is obscene and what isn't? What I know of Houston Media Source is it's a way to voice your opinion, to voice your freedom of speech, something that's given to each of us. And when you start stepping on what should be said and what shouldn't, what's the point of it at all? I haven't seen anything on Houston Media Source that I haven't seen on the Discovery Channel at 3 o'clock in the morning. Sexually explicit materials, I've seen much more on the Discovery Channel. Obscenity, I've seen more of it today than I have in a while. As far as conduct of people in the City Hall, I was just sitting there and I saw a gentleman who was acting strange, and you know, I thought the Houston police officer would go over there and say something to him, but you know what, he didn't. You know why? Because he has freedom of speech. He has the right to sit and say whatever he wants or have whatever position he feels is right. Thank you.
Thank you. City Secretary, did you?
Okay, I've been asked to remind the audience of the rules of council relating to, it says, no person within any public aisles or seating area of the City Council chamber shall applaud, boo, clap, or otherwise audibly express approval or disapproval of the actions being taken at the council table or the public speaker's podium in a loud or raunchous manner calculated to disturb the meeting except for public recognition initiated by City Council. City Council would appreciate your observance of those rules, and the speakers can be heard in a more orderly manner. Thank you.
Councilmember Edwards.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Douglas, for coming down. But before I go to Mr. Douglas, Madam Mayor Pro Tem, I wanted to ask Ms. Taylor, there's been several back and forths as to whether or not who's paying for this public ask. And I'm reading your memo dated July 6th, and it says, operation of the single public access channel is funded entirely by a specific charge levied by each franchise cable operator for that purpose. What does that mean?
That means that there are no tax dollars, no city revenues that go to support Houston Media Source or the municipal channel for that matter, that it is funded entirely through a user fee that is required in our city franchises.
So there's no tax dollars that
no, ma'am.
Fund and underwrite this channel, regardless of it's obscene or not obscene?
That's correct.
Okay. It kind of reminds me of the role that KPFT Pacifica Radio plays in the public role there. Mr. Douglas, you're 18 years of age?
Yes, ma'am.
Do you produce at public access?
No, I don't. I'm just a viewer.
You just view it. You
yes,
just
ma'am.
Watch it. Well, could you tell me, what do you think, you've been watching access for a long time, what do you think it offers to the average citizen of Houston?
I think it offers the same thing the municipal channel offers, but at a full blast of a difference. Mm-hmm. With Houston Media Source, just around election time, the city council members are sometimes featured on Houston Media Source. Mm-hmm. And for some people who do not have the funds to spend, you know, with these huge campaigns, that's the only, you know, way of communicating with people that they have. That's one of the things that I enjoyed about Houston Media Source, also the other call-in shows. Mm-hmm. And it's just a huge benefit to Houston and to people as a whole to be able to look at something, to hear someone else's opinion, and to voice back and forth, to give your own.
If you were if this were being paid by taxpayer money, your dollars,
yes, ma'am.
Would you be offended?
I wouldn't at all.
What is your thought process on the whole idea of free speech? What does that mean?
Free speech to me bears no censorship, okay? Freedom of speech means I can say whatever I want to say, and I can't be prosecuted for it or punished for it. You know what I mean? If I want to say, you know, Councilmember Wiseman, I don't like those stripes you're wearing, I can say that. Mm-hmm. If I want to say, that's a nice button you're wearing, Miss Gibbs, I can say that.
Well, all I can say to you, Mr. Douglas, and to Mr. Moore, we hear a lot about what our young people aren't doing and how disconnected they are from the system and how uninvolved they are. And how they're just hanging out, just chilling, just, you know. So I'm very encouraged that regardless of whether or not I agree with you or not, that you took the time to come down here on a Wednesday morning to voice your opinion on this issue. And I'm very encouraged by that, what you said and Mr. Morris said. Ms. Taylor, one final question for you. The whole paragraph that's on this memo implies to me that there is no taxpayer money involved in any of the either the educational channels, HISD, HCC channel, and Media Source. So this is all money that is just passed through us to.
Right. It's a special user fee. It is not tax. It is not tax funds that go to fund these PEG channels.
And so, what is our role on City Council with this whole issue of money and these channels?
In that, what we have is the authority or responsibility to award the contract for the public access portion of the PEG channels. HISD has an educational channel. We award the contract for the program or for the production of the public access channel.
And that awarding is done through the regular process of how we do contracts?
In fact, there was an RFP for this particular contract. There were at least, I guess, four proposers at various points for the access channel. The recommendation is to award to Houston Media Source, but it did go through an RFP just as any other city contract would.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you, Madam.
Thank you. Councilmember Wiseman, you'll be the first one on the next speaker.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Robert Zipp. Mr. Zipp will be followed by Mr. Ray Hill.
Good morning, and thank you for this opportunity to speak before you as a concerned citizen and as a producer at Houston Media Source. My question here today is whether or not Houston Media Source should receive funding in order to operate as Houston's only truly independent media outlet. As their name implies, it is Houston's only source for independent media, and I believe that should not be compromised. Out of all the channels on the television dial, Houston Media Source is the only one that allows everyday citizens to produce and broadcast whatever they want. Who is to say whose voices should and should not be heard? Giant conglomerate media empires say that only they should have the right to broadcast. That's why you see Congress attempt to kill PBS and NPR. But these politicians and corporate bullies don't remember that the airwaves belong to the people. Without a public forum, the only viewpoints will be those of a select few, and that is a very dangerous thing. Now, what sparked this whole debate was a program that Councilwoman Wiseman deemed as offensive. This program was on in the middle of the night, as is every program with foul language as per the HMS guidelines. They do the best they can to assure that anything with foul language or nudity be shown when most people are asleep and won't likely see the program. But Mrs. Wiseman did see the program and was offended because, in her words, the language was the worst I've heard in a long time and possibly even ever. Was the language any more offensive than the misogynistic comedy routine of the late Houston comic Sam Kinison, which you performed with when you were a stand-up comic yourself? Or was she just offended because the material wasn't up to her comedic standards? Either way, it's irrelevant. No one has the right to infringe upon someone else's First Amendment rights of freedom of speech. And beyond the security-guarded gates of the master plan communities of Kingwood and Clear Lake lies an extremely diverse city. Every nationality in the world has a part in shaping and molding the makeup of Houston. For many people of a foreign background, Houston Media Source is the only way to reach other people like them in this city. Where else can you see news programs from China, India, and Africa? Not on KPRC, where local news comes first. I'm also very disappointed that in all of this, nothing has been mentioned about what Houston Media Source does for the city's youth. They have a summer video program that teaches children how to use video equipment and how to make their own show. Not only does this provide them useful skills that will help them in the job market in the future, but it gives them a positive outlet during the summer and helps keep them off of the streets. Much like the Boy Scouts, they teach valuable life lessons and help create memories that last a lifetime. I myself was a Boy Scout at Troop 544 in the north side of town, and on my way to earning my Eagle Scout rank 10 years ago, I learned many important things. But one of the most important is that if you believe that something is unjust, you do everything within the rule of law to change that.
Thank you. Councilmember Wiseman.
Thank you. I'm glad you ended your comments with "you do everything within the rule of law."
Right.
Well, that
That's
would suggest I have
Sorry.
The floor.
Okay.
That would suggest that you believe we should adhere to the law, and you said that no one is prohibited from airing anything. May I, Councilmember? Thank you. Airing anything that they wish to air, and that it is. Because I find it objectionable. What I find objectionable is that the law is being violated, that the contractual obligations are being dismissed. It's very clear, FCC, United States Code, I will read it to you. It is a violation of federal law to broadcast obscene program at any time, and that is the law.
May I reply?
No, I'm not finished. Because you certainly had a lot to say about me and my objections.
Okay.
Sam Kinison, I knew Sam Kinison, and Sam Kinison never aired his show on the Access Channel. The Access Channel does provide programming that is appropriate, and it is that content that we do not censor, and we do not wish to censor. I'm not here to say what I like and what I don't like, and that we're going to put programming on there that we like or don't like. It's about the law and what is permissible by law and what is restricted by law. And that is what I'm addressing. And that's our obligation. We do pay for this. I pay for this because I subscribe to cable. Every cable subscriber is required. We are forced in our cable bill to pay for this. And the city makes that requirement. It's the city that puts that forward. And federal law does not mandate that we're exposed to this. Because if we're paying for this, then it is an issue that we can address. The decision of this channel is made here. So it is our responsibility to make sure that we adhere to this. It doesn't matter what time of the day or night that it's aired. If it's obscene, it's obscene. And it's not for me to determine what's obscene. As you said, it's not for any of us to determine. It is prescribed in law. It is very clear in the law what is obscene, and it cannot be aired. Our very own code of ordinances says the same thing. I want to protect the city's youth. I want to protect these kids from being exposed to this. And we as a society and as a community have that right. Free speech does have its limits. It's very clear in federal law. It has its limits. The limits that you have are placed here according to our rules. As a society, we have to have rules and regulations, and we have to have laws. And what I am asking for is that these laws be adhered to. No one has a right to violate the law and for us to turn and look away because we have sworn to uphold the law. So it's our responsibility. And with respect to being able to say whatever you want to say, again, you can't. It can't be done. And we do pay for it. The public who subscribes to cable service is forced to pay for it. So we shouldn't have to have that. And when I say garbage, I talk about the obscenity. And again, it's not my definition. It's the definition under law. Because there is programming on there that I don't particularly like, but I do change the channel. I don't watch it. And as far as changing the channel on the other stuff, I'm not going to look away at the flagrant violation of law because it's my duty to make sure that the law is enforced, that people follow the law. And that's how we protect free speech. I am very, very concerned about any effort to restrict free speech. But cable programming, according to the United States Code, is not protected under the free speech provisions within the Constitution. It is not protected. The obscenity in no way is protected. We cannot open strip clubs next to schools to protect our children. We cannot open liquor stores next to schools. And we certainly have a right to restrict, we have a right and an obligation to restrict obscenity on the public airways. Thank you.
Member, our council time has expired, and the Mayor Pro Tem has done a good job at setting some rules so we get through the agenda today. We'll abide by that 5-minute rule, and the next council person seeking recognition, Councilmember Khan, can I recognize you at the next speaker? Please call the next speaker.
Okay, Mr. Ray Hill will be followed by Ms. T.J. Smythe.
Thank you, Ms. Russell, and Mayor, members of council. I am Ray Hill, and I am the host, but not the producer, of Sex, Truth, and Videotape, a media source program that has gotten a lot of attention in the media lately. And I want to thank Councilmember Wiseman for promoting my show in the media and encouraging a large listening audience. However, I'm afraid that the listening audience is going to be tuning in looking for some pretty spicy stuff. And basically, we do an interview show. And my next guest is Pastor George, and I've been trying to figure out how to sauce Pastor George up to satisfy the expectation of my newly attracted audience. That doesn't seem likely or even possible for that matter. I know a thing or two about the First Amendment, my lawyers and I do. We have in two separate federal cases taught the city of Houston a great deal about the First Amendment, including the United States Supreme Court case, Houston versus Hill, and I would like to express my appreciation to the taxpayers of Houston for compensating my lawyers adequately and paying me very handsomely for the time I spent in jail in that case. And we're prepared to do that again. But obscenity occurs only and always when it is adjudicated obscene in a court. There is no prior restraint on the First Amendment. But unless you have studied Griswold versus Commonwealth's attorney and or studied the California case that determines what the definition of obscenity is in the law, you don't have a hint about what the First Amendment really stands for. I have litigated the First Amendment against this city on two separate federal occasions, and it's become easier to deal with me across the desk than it is in the courtroom because I simply can afford better lawyers than you have. And so I regret being lectured to by someone who hasn't read Griswold or who hasn't read the other major landmark cases in that decision that defines what obscenity is. It is more than political grandstand. It's kind of like a Pekingese barking at the postman whenever people around this table bark into their microphones and filibuster so nobody can respond to their monologues. That, my friends, is politically obscene. I started coming into this building and talking about the political and community concerns of the gay community when Louis Welch was mayor.
Thank you. Your time has expired.
Thank you, Ms. Russell.
And Mr. Hill, Chair recognizes Councilmember Chan.
Thank you, Mayor. Mr. Hill, thank you for coming here and enlightening us with many things. You said you produce a show?
I do.
Excuse me, I correct that.
I don't produce a show. I am the host, but not the producer of the show. That's technically a thing.
Okay. And is that played only in Houston and or any
yes.
other cities also?
It is only played on Houston Media Source, Channel 17 Houston.
Okay. Do you know of any other cities where shows in question in Houston are played also?
Houston is in general, answer to your question, Houston is a very productive studio. In other words, we produce a lot of local programs. Some of them are then carried forth and played in Austin or Dallas or in other cities. Mine is not. I'm not willing to work that hard to promote it. But I have appeared on Dallas Access Media, and I have appeared in Austin on their media channel.
And I don't know whether you would know it or not, but let me ask you anyway. The show in question, I don't even know what's the name of that show, which my honorable colleague watched late at night one time and found violating the law. Do you know if that show is played in any other city?
No, I'm sorry. I can't answer that question.
Okay. That's all I have. Thank you.
Thank you.
Chair recognizes Councilmember Galloway.
Thank you, Mr. Heer, for coming and bringing your opinion. I was listening to my colleague as she advocate stated that was against the law. I feel like we hire persons who have expertise in the law that do work for the city, although you stated that you may have won some cases against our attorneys. But I'm sure they are fully aware of the meaning of freedom of speech and what is a violation of the law. I did ask my colleague to furnish me with her interpretation of the law. Where did she acquire her information from? Which is from Parent Place. So I guess when you put things on the web, you put whatever you feel is most appropriate for that occasion. But it does state that in the communication, the Constitution of the Communication Act prohibits the FCC from censoring broadcast material in most cases from making a regulation that would interfere with freedom of speech. That is also noted in the information
prior restraint, excuse me, I didn't mean to interrupt, but prior restraint is not permitted under the FCC code. If you do it wrong, then they take you to court afterwards. So that's what the prior restraint issue is. And I would like to remind you that the FCC code applies to broadcast media.
Okay.
It does not apply to anything that comes in your house through a solid copper wire or over a satellite.
Okay. One way the attorney, our attorney, explained to us is from a user's fee by having cable. So any person who don't want to contribute can disconnect that cable, and so whatever comes on, I assume, would be all right. Is that not the case? You would agree?
Pretty much. Pretty much.
Now, I would like to ask our attorney as well. I have not seen this so-called program. I've been trying to find out when this so-called program come on. So I could interpret what I, you know, each individual persons interpret what they think is indecent obscenity. They do interpret at their own thinking. I have not seen it. I don't know if it's a standard when this program come on or not to see it, to even interpret. But from what I'm hearing, do you agree that this is a violation of freedom of speech?
I'm not sure exactly what you're referring to by this.
This
but
program,
clearly,
I don't know. Yeah. Have you seen this so-called program, Brother?
No, I haven't.
Okay. Have anyone on council seen it?
The city, as a franchising entity, is prohibited from entering into any sort of restriction on the content of programming. Houston Media Source is prohibited from entering into restrictions on the content of programming other than as to obscenity. And obscenity is a relatively well-defined concept in the law, and it is not the use of inappropriate language.
Okay, it's only the language that we're speaking of here.
I'm not sure what was on the program. I know at the last week's meeting, that was the issue that the council member raised, was the use of some perhaps inappropriate language.
So it's only one council member. Okay. All right, then. Thank you. I have an interpretation. Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you, Mr. Hill.
Thank you, Mayor.
Time for discussion has expired, and I will recognize the next council member seeking recognition after the next speaker. If you could call the next speaker.
Name is T.C. Smythe. I don't believe it.
We're driving down West Dallas now, headed to the post office.
We're on West Gray, and we're headed toward town, which will ultimately become the post office.
I wanted to ask you about what tips. Well, okay. Access. Houston, or Houston Media Source, the public access channel in Houston, just got through with probably the fourth big battle for our survival in history. And I know that a lot of people got a lot of letters written, but it's my opinion that you were the straw that broke the camel's back. Can you tell us about that?
Well, I don't know if I deserve very much credit, but I am pretty good at analyzing politics. I mean, politics that real people can utilize in their lives and for important issues before them. And what was happening at Access Cable is the mayor wanted to kill it. But the mayor of the city of Houston doesn't like to get his hands dirty, so he was going to have someone else carry the water. And at first, he chose Addie Wiseman to carry his water. The trouble with that was that the method that Addie was going to use was censorship. She saw something on Access Cable, or someone told her they saw something on Access Cable that was offensive. And so she decided that offensive means the same thing as obscene. So she was going to carry the mayor's water into the public arena and do something about shutting Access Cable down, justified on censorship. The problem with that is that obscenity is legally a very specific thing. And what she saw was not obscene under the law. Anyway, so she decided to apply a different standard. And that standard she chose to apply, this is rock and roll time.
Okay.
The standard she, you can go straight and get there.
Okay.
The standard she decided to apply was decency. The only problem is decency does not apply to broadcast or to media that is like access cable.
Right.
Decency applies to broadcast media where the public airwaves are used to distribute that.
Talk about the thing with Clutterbuck, okay. Because in my view, and you tell me, you cast this in your own light, but it seems to me that a lot of, I want this in the context of how to...
That way and wide.
Okay. That political battles, it seems like you, if you want to coach people on how to operate their democracy, it would seem like you want us to tell people, organize the vote and vote, because political battles are fought on narrow margins. And talk about that, and then talk about how Clutterbuck, how you yanked her endorsement and threatened her with not re-election.
Well,
and that saved access.
Well, you do not need to have a majority of the votes to win an election. You have to have one vote over half of the margin. That's how you win elections. In other words, if somebody's going to get elected by a margin of 10%, say one's going to get a 45% of the vote and the other's going to get a 55% of the vote, that's a 10% margin. So whoever shows up with 5% plus one vote, then that splits the margin and they get to pick the winner. That's the simple arithmetic of politics that nobody thinks about. Everybody thinks about, how do I get a majority of the vote to win this election or to push this candidate over top? Don't worry about that. Just worry about the margin. It's simpler, it's smaller numbers, and all you need is enough discipline in your voting block. And it helps if you're moving voters that would normally vote for one side over to the other side, because basically that gives you a double whammy. You take 5% of the votes over here away from this candidate, and you put 5% of the votes over here in favor of this candidate. As a result, you've actually had a springboard of 10% of the vote all by yourself. Mm-hmm. So, Clutterbuck was carrying the water for the mayor in the second round. And so she got up and she was having a good time telling supporters of Access Cable that they were spending too much money and the money was needed elsewhere in the budget, and they were going to do a starve it to death routine. Well, the thing that the mayor didn't realize whenever he picked Clutterbuck to carry his water is that Clutterbuck had only recently been elected to city council, and Houston Gay and Lesbian Political Caucus votes gave her more votes than her margin of victory. So she won with that support. So all I had to do is to go to a meeting of Houston Gay, Lesbian, Transgendered Political Caucus and pull her endorsement out of an automatic endorsement on the recommendation of the committee to be considered separately. Well, that caused everybody in the room to hold their breath. What's Ray up to? What's going on here? And so when we considered her race separately, I simply said, Clutterbuck is carrying the water for the mayor that will ultimately destroy Access Cable. I'm not going to block her endorsement, but I'm going to ask everybody in this room to get in touch with her and tell her that public access media is the only media available to this community, and it is important enough for us to defend. And then we can go ahead and endorse her with the caveat that everybody in this room contact her. Well, everybody did, including the chair of the endorsement committee and the president of the caucus and me and others. Said, all right, you're on the wrong string here. when Clutterbuck went to the mayor and said, wait a minute, you're jeopardizing my security on city council, then the mayor had lost the only available horse, well, the one he had chosen. And so rather than regroup and come up with another whole idea and cause Clutterbuck to have problems, he decided to announce at the very next city council meeting that there would be no reduction of funding for public access media as long as he remained mayor. Translation, we won, he surrendered.
Yay. Can you, I'd like you to use that as a lesson. One of the things I wanted you to tell the people watching this is, how would you coach people to operate their democracy?
Well, the way to operate democracy for people and other worthy living things is to maximize your strength. In other words, you identify people who, for whatever reason, think the same things you do. That's easy with the gay and lesbian transgendered community because these are folks that have been oppressed for years. And so that's the group that I've organized into a political bloc, simply by working on their oppression, by standing up to the cops when the cops came, by standing up to gay bashers when they showed up, by standing up to the religious right-wing manipulators. And so I develop a reputation of leadership with courage. They kind of know me as the fruit with nuts. And so you use that courage long enough and people will get in a habit of listening to your voice. And when people get in the habit of listening to your voice, then you have their attention to give them advice. Remember, politics is a numbers game. It's not a big numbers game. It's a little numbers game. Because all you need is 50% of the margin plus one vote, and you get to pick the winner. So actually, if you're in a political environment where the margin of victory between who is mayor or governor or president is a very small percentage of all of the votes, then you only need half of that small percentage.
Plus one.
Plus one.
In my lifetime, and I'm 66 years old, native Houstonian, and I've been in the media all of my life, we have never been more poorly served by the media in all of that time. I have been around and interested in the media since I was a whiz kid on that series on PBS when I was still in elementary school. I did my debut as an adult on Ray Miller's The Last Word Show when Channel 2 was in a Quonset building where the Galleria is now. And so that's black and white television days for both of those, and I've come a long way inside the media then. In 1968, a group of us got together because word was Texas Institution, Texas Observer was about to belly up, and we were going to lose the only progressive voice in Texas politics. And we were desperate for an alternative. And it was my idea that we needed more than one anyway. And so Deborah Danberg, Larry Lee, Don Gardner, and myself got together and we decided we would build a radio station in Houston and ask the Pacifica Foundation, which didn't even know we exist, to co-sponsor us so we didn't have to go through the license procedure as neophytes. That was 1968, 1970, KPFT got its license, was promptly bombed off the air by the Klan, which is something we should have expected, and we built it again. Miss Dominique DeMille gave us $140,000, and so we wired up a station and got back on the air, and then we got bombed off for the second time by the same guy. and because the idea of discussing racial equality, women's equality, and certainly, again, lesbian rights was something they just didn't, and the anti-war years. It was those years in the late 1960s and 1970s. Well, what has changed? What has changed until now is that we used to get better news on CBS. Walter Cronkite came back and said, things I've been telling you about the war are not true. That could not happen today. Could not happen today. You know, I have this vision of Rupert Murdoch sitting somewhere on a yacht, kind of like Tiberius in Capri, as Rome fell into disarray, trying to figure out what he's going to tell Bush or Blair or whoever he's going to tell to rule the world today what to do. We're in desperate shape. Corporate media has taken over. There was a word for that one time. We called it fascism, when everything was lined up to support big business and big business ruled and dominated the priorities of the country, and that is the state we live in today. It's not that the government is such a censor. They don't have to. The corporations in their interest have dumbed down news so that we don't get any information. I'm a junkie. I wake up in the morning for 1 hour of NPR news. And it pains me that almost 12% of that broadcast time is underwriters, is advertising of various varieties. On beloved NPR, National Public Radio, is all that. And I listen to, this program is brought to you by the University of Texas Medical Branch in Galveston. And then they read a news release from the University of Texas Medical Branch in Galveston that said that their research had discovered that Texas inmates get better health care than people with insurance in the free world. And I know that's a lie because I cover that beat as a journalist. And the only reason it's there is because one of their underwriters is the University of Texas Medical Branch in Galveston. And then they give me the business news. And the business news is underwritten by every corporation that I think we need to watch carefully in order to protect free enterprise. They're all a bunch of monopolists. And that is the sad state of public radio. And then I listen to Amy Goodman on Houston Media Source. I get a 7 o'clock fix with Amy Goodman. And I hear an entirely different perspective than I have just heard from People's public access media. And then I get the Imperial News from the BBC for an hour. BBC will give me an angle on things that I'm not going to get on CBS, NBC, ABC, or PBS. And so then I feel like I'm brave enough to turn on some kind of commercial radio and get some ideas from some other places, because I've stoked myself and insulated myself and inoculated myself. Houston has two media outlets reliably that are not under corporate dictator control. One of those is my beloved Pacifica radio station, which also carries Amy Goodman, but at 9 o'clock. The other of those is Houston Media Source. We come by Houston Media Source by a contract with the cable carriers. It is our, meaning the people's, airwaves. We own it because the cable company uses our public right-of-ways to distribute their signal either over electric cable or over fiber optic cable. But in any case, it goes telephone pole to telephone pole and down public streets and thoroughfares. They distribute their material on land that we own. Their payment for doing that is to set aside funds to finance municipal channel, whereby we get city council, and I can sit there and watch you folks perform before city council without actually having to go down there and expose myself to whatever they're carrying these days. And the other thing is that they provide less expensive space for educational channels. And then there is the crown jewel, public access television. Public access television means that this man, or I, or you, or anybody can go down there and produce the media you want to produce. You get to decide what it's about. You get to decide what it contains. You get to decide the depth of material. You get to decide what you only had. There are a few things you can't do. You can't use the vehicle as a commercial outlet because it is provided to you as a free service for your ideas, not your business. A reasonable limitation. I utilize that access. As a matter of fact, if it weren't for the media, I would not exist at all. My prison show on radio station KPFT, which had run 27 years, the gay and lesbian radio programs that I began before that, which ran has been running now since 1975. My infrequent visits to Houston Media Source, and the fact that I am one of the great one-liner deliverers of all times, and I can manipulate Lois Lane thereby. She comes to me for one-liners because it saves her room in the edit time. I mean, edit time in the edit room. She don't have to cut that. I mean, I give her a sound bite and away we go. And so that if those people didn't pay attention with me, if I hadn't generated sources within the media so that I come across comment on a broad range of things, there would be no Ray Hill at all. And if everybody got treated well and then equally in the society, there would be no need of there to be a Ray Hill in the society. But I am obliged by the instructions given me by my parents to try to fix the world to my generation, and I'm going to work on it as best I can. Who were my parents? They were labor organizers. Frankie tried to organize nurses for the AFL, for the Teamsters. My father tried to organize shipyard workers for the AFL-CIO. I grew up in a room where Saul Alinsky was as frequently discussed at our breakfast table as my grandparents. And so that's the natural environment which I come. I can assure you that a better world can be built, but not without access to media. If we can't, who we are, whatever our ideas we have, if we can't access media with some degree of reliability, our hopes and dreams of a better world are wasted. Absolutely wasted. Television, they have set aside certain channels for television that are public television, and that we get Channel 8 here. Ta-da! Remember that? Set by the University of Houston. I was one of the first people on Channel 8. That's when I was a whiz kid. And you go back, and that station has done well. How does Channel 8 pay for itself? Does the University of Houston underwrite it? No. University of Houston decided they didn't need to carry the liability, so they make the listeners to Channel 8 pay for it, and that has emerged now into a commercial radio station, a television station. I mean, if Lexus brings me one more program, I'll just have to go out and buy a Mazda, I guess. That's just the way that is. I mean, I get to see all these wonderful television programs underwritten by all these wonderful corporations. Of course, they never say anything bad about those corporations on that television station because that's their mother's milk. The mayor says that public access television should be funded the same. Whoa, wait a minute. We got KTSU seeking funds. We got KJOJ, or is it K something better than Jesus? But anyway, we've got two or three Christian stations broadcasting looking for funds. We've got Channel 8 broadcasting looking for funds. We've got KUHF, the FM radio station, looking for funds. And we've got Rice University looking for funds. And we've got KPFT looking for funds. And now we're going to have public access television. How deep is that bucket anyway? And why is that necessary? How are we, the citizens, compensated for the cable companies using our property to distribute their signal. What happened to that idea? It's in the federal statute that authorizes accessing franchise. But let me tell you something. He is not going to pull the plug on city council on television. That is not going to happen. So somehow the city is going to figure out how to fund that one, but unfund us. You see, the medium is being compromised by the mendacity of the power broker.
I'm wanting to know about what can we do. Cherie asked, what can we do? One of the things we're talking about, you're talking about, is sending email, visiting city council. I'm down with that, totally down with that. I really am intrigued by the idea of a citizen lawsuit. And when you said that, okay, a listener, we don't have the right to listen to what we want to, but we do have the right to say what we want to. And we've got a 7-year history of having done that. So your Green Party dues have been going to help fund this, and we need to preserve that right. I'd like to help with
I will interlope, since you're on the air, since you have standing as a producer, as these talks develop, as my lawyers develop the standing issue, because it more of us is always better than few of us.
Right. Well, it'd be better to keep it from falling than to try to pick it back up after they defund it, right?
Right.
But so we need, our actions need to be now.
What was going on tonight, Ray?
Well, it was a meeting of the Green Party here at Central Market, and they wanted me to come talk about the need to preserve and adequately fund Houston Media Source. And that's one of my favorite topics, because it's people's media, and if there's anything Ray Hill believes in, it's the importance of getting more and preserving what people's media is available.
You talked about being a teenage evangelist in Colmenille, Texas. Did you go back to Pasadena after that?
Well, no, I wasn't from Pasadena. I was by the time Colmenille happened, I was a junior at Galena Park High School. So I went back to high school. My friends were all jealous of the fact that I had a new Studebaker and they didn't, and that I had earned it by being a teenage evangelist, which they weren't, and that I had more freedom than they did simply because I had more money than they did. And so I come back to high school, and the first thing they need to know is that I'm not doing that line of work anymore. I decided that was dishonest, and so I stopped doing that. And it would be another year before I would come out of the closet as a gay person. And I suppose there is some thought that when you've been a big man on campus and a star because of the Studebaker and the preaching and all of that, then you kind of want to maintain that, so you got to come up with something that is bigger and better than that. And in 1958, coming out of the closet as a gay man certainly got me another round of astute attention among my peers at Galena Park. The following year, 1959, my senior year, I would quit drinking on the trip to Havana. Got down there and was responsible for those other guys, and was drunk and afraid I'd do something stupid, so I stopped drinking. And when I confessed that I thought I had a problem to Raymond, my father, then he suggested AA, and I went, and I've been in that program now for over 48 and a half years. And that was a very smart move. I think coming out of the closet was a very smart move. I think giving up preaching was a very smart move. When I went into the burglary business, which wouldn't happen until, see, I would leave high school and become a college bum. And in order to accomplish that, I would perpetrate several hoaxes in order to pull that off. And but whenever I got through with that cycle, I became an activist in the anti-war movement against the Vietnam War, and I became involved in civil rights and other movement-oriented things. And ultimately, I would go into the burglary business. Exactly how I did that was I looked at the crime statistics, and I noticed that of all of the crimes that you could go into for financial gain, burglary was, they didn't have a solve rate on burglars. Only about 3% of all burglaries get solved. And most of those are like breaking in people's houses and stealing their cutlery. Commercial burglaries are only about 0.3% of those get solved. And so obviously going into commercial burglary is the lowest risk of crime behavior. And then when you look at the recovery rate of things that are stolen, very little property stolen from residential locations is ever recovered. And almost none of the stuff from commercial burglaries are ever recovered, if you don't count those burglars caught in the act because they're too ignorant to manipulate the alarm systems. So I looked at this just like any other career. I studied alarm systems. And so whenever I got that down, and we were talking about the 1960s, alarm systems may look very complicated and scary to other people, but it all boils down to each system is either open circuit or closed circuit. If it's closed circuit and you could get to those points, you simply wrap a wire around them so they don't open. If it's open circuit, and you can get to those points, you put a piece of paper between them so they never close. So it's a matter of following wires and figuring out how to get to the alarm system. Oh, they can have trip wires and electronic devices on the doors and the windows, and they can have all of that. But if you can get to the control box, it's either or, and that's not real complicated. And if you can't get to the control box, you might figure out a way to get them to turn the mother off. How would you do that? Go down and trap a feral cat.
Why a feral cat? Well, you don't want to go get somebody's tabby, because if you put somebody's tabby into a place of business, they're going to set off the alarm system, and when somebody comes in to check it out, they can say, how did this cat get here? And turn the alarm system back on and leave. So you get a feral cat. Why? Because if somebody comes to find out why the alarm system isn't working, the cat will hide and they can't find it. And then when they leave, the cat will prowl and set off the alarm system again. Well, you do that three times and the security system says, there's something wrong here, and they'll turn the mother off. And then you own the store. And I specialized in things that queers are supposed to know something about. Antiques, art, jewels, and electronics. And I didn't fence that stuff off for 10 cents on the dollar. I opened up my own antique store. I did business with a jewel maker. I handled art in the open market. I mean, there's some things in the art field that you literally cannot steal. I wound up with a Renoir one time. Well, how the hell do you unload a Renoir? Well, actually, you don't. Unloading it will only create a trail back to you. So I gave it to a little museum in Mississippi and didn't give it another thought. Anonymously, of course. For the jewel jobs, I knew a jewel thief who already lived near Oaxaca, Mexico, who supported a little village. It was kind of a self-financed Peace Corps. Put him in a water system and a sewage system and built a school for the kids and bought them books and provided good services. But he was a very professional jewel thief, and I just shipped him the jewels and he remounted them and reformed them and sold them on the open market in Europe, and I got half the money that he made.
Did you see yourself as a Robin Hood?
Oh, at least. I had all kinds of rationalization. First, I'm a gay guy, right? I'm already an outlaw. There are laws against queers in this country. You can go to prison for being queer in this country. So I'm already an outlaw. So what more could I do to myself? Plus the fact, being a poor gay guy who has experience of hanging around with Tennessee Williams and rich queens in New Orleans and seeing them flit and fly around New York, San Francisco, mission days in San Diego, opening of the beaches of Fort Lauderdale, even splash day in Galveston. All of that takes money. Money that I needed and deserved. And so I had all kinds of elaborate rationalization. Actually, being a burglar is not bad work. I mean, you make good money if you do it right. You're not going to make any money if you waste your money on addictions, but I'd already sobered up and wasn't going to mess with any drugs. You don't make good money if you fence stuff off of 10 cents a dollar, and that only creates a trail back to you so that you'll get busted. The only thing about the burglary system that I didn't like was the retirement plan. And I retired as a result of an income tax investigation, at the end of which the federal government had determined that I had paid some $89,000 more taxes than my reported income could justify. So they wrote me a check and sent it to me while I was in prison. But they did find a warehouse full of stolen antiques. And I was sentenced to 160 years. I wound up serving 4 years, 4 months, and 17 days before getting out on basically an Eighth Amendment writ, claiming that it was cruel and unusual punishment for someone to get 20 consecutive 8-year sentences as a result of nonviolent crimes against property.
How did you work that writ through the, how did you get that
How do you make that work, the writ?
Oh, my lawyer said it wouldn't work. I had a good lawyer. I mean, we're going through the process. He's leaning up. The day we had the hearing, or we're supposed to have the hearing, I met him in a federal courtroom in Houston. He said, this ain't going to work. He said, we're pissing up a rope. His rationale is, as long as Texas is executing people, what's wrong with mistreating a few? This is going to be a complete failure. You're wasting your time and your energy. Nothing's going to go anywhere here. But I knew that we were in a court where the judge actually knew my family, and the judge was pro-labor organizing, pro-civil rights. And we were in John Singleton's court. Had been a labor lawyer before he became a federal judge. And so we went into Judge Singleton's court, but only Judge Singleton wasn't there. He had taken the day off because his daughter was getting married. And we had a visiting judge from Palestine, Texas, that I'd never heard of. And I thought, well, here goes my chances. But come to find it out, that judge wanted to go golfing. He said, we got some great golf courses in Houston, and you don't know how bad the golf courses are up in Palestine, Texas. I mean, we got gophers, and so you don't even know what hole you're shooting at because the gophers are making a new one overnight. And if you ain't careful, the squirrels will run off with your balls. He literally said that. Looked to me like the state of Texas could come to some kind of understanding with this fellow, so I didn't have to listen to this hearing. The translation is that there was no legal precedent that allowed him to do anything about my sentence. So my lawyer and the state's lawyer went outside and they consulted. My lawyer and the state's lawyer went outside and they consulted while the judge disappeared into the anteroom, and they came back and sat down. And as they came in, the judge came in, and my lawyer leaned over and whispered, I've got it all figured out. Well, we're talking about my life here, and I do not know what that means. So I'm beginning to get uptight. They changed one word in my sentence from 20 consecutive 8-year sentences to 20 concurrent 8-year sentences. So I only had 8 to do. I had been a trustee since I first drove up, and so I completed that 160-year sentence in 4 years, 4 months, and 10 days.
I heard you talk earlier about you felt like an outlaw and you were rebelling against. Did you ever have any other sort of philosophical, ethical problems with it?
No. No, I had some standards about my burglary. I never broke into anyone's houses and stole their cutlery. Never did. I never broke into a business that, number one, wasn't worth breaking into. And number two, all of the places that I broke into had alarm systems. So they were actually paying lower premiums for their insurance than places without alarm systems. And number three, I only stole what I could put to good use. So I thought I was Robin Hood, you know, steal from the rich and give to myself, the worthy poor, of course. And I lived very well. I was back in Studebakers or better. Unfortunately, they weren't making Studebakers at that time, so.
We got that, right? can you talk now, can we do the 1, 2, 3 about the three cases that established privacy?
Sure.
After I got out of prison, I decided that the way to do something about my being criminal simply because I was queer would be to do something about the laws that make queers criminals. The problem in Texas was that Section 21.06 of the Penal Code was a Class C misdemeanor, punishable by fine only, not to exceed $200. Why is that a problem? I mean, that's the lowest thing. It's a problem because the legislature, in getting rid of the old sodomy statute for which they could arrest people and send them ultimately to prison, and I've met five old men who were sentenced to life in Texas prison for multiple convictions under the sodomy statute. While I was in prison in 1973, the Texas legislature understood from the Alvin Buchanan case that there were some constitutional issues in the sodomy statute. So they wrote a new penal code in 1973 and just left it out. Well, Governor Dolph Briscoe, who was very Southern Baptist, I mean, he was so Baptist, they didn't serve bourbon and branch water in the governor's mansion during his term. Now, not serving bourbon and branch water in the governor's mansion is more than being a teetotaler. So what they did was they wrote Section 21.06 as a Class C misdemeanor because that was the lowest offense, and the governor, seeing it was in there, signed it in the legislation, but it was not enforced. In the jurisdiction of Harris County, from 1973 until 1998, 73 to 98, there were exactly five Section 2106 cases in the free world. One of them, they accused a guy of violating the statute by himself. I can't do that. Most people I know can't do that. I didn't get a look at him to see if he could actually do that. It's an anatomical impossibility.
For most people.
For most people. And so he was acquitted. On the same day, in the same jurisdiction, they arrested two other guys for having sex in their camper parked at San Jacinto Monument. The DPS officer walked by and he says the wind blew the curtain and the curtain lifted and he saw two guys violating Section 2106. Good case. I mean, constitutionally, everything, he didn't violate their privacy, anything. So he charged them, but a gay lawyer in Houston decided what he needed to do was collect a fee rather than deal on the constitutional principle. So I lost that case to a greedy, incompetent, dipshit gay lawyer. I would say his name, but I would get so bad we'd have to end the interview. So, along comes 1998. I'm at home, abed, asleep at 3 o'clock in the morning. I get a call from former manager over here at one of the gay bars, and Lane Lewis tells me that a friend of his has been arrested for 2106. It's 3 o'clock in the morning. And I said, Lane, nobody gets arrested for 2106. Nobody. You mean you woke me up in the middle of the night to tell me somebody got arrested for weenie wiggling in a bookstore arcade I don't want to just, you know, bail him out of jail. We'll talk to a lawyer tomorrow. And he said, no, this guy was arrested in his apartment. And then I woke up because an arrest for 2106 would have to happen in somebody's private space. So John Garner and John Lawrence and Tyrone Garner, an older white man, a younger black man, had been busted for violating 2106. So the first thing I had to do is to keep Judge Parrott in East Harris County from dismissing the case. Judge Parrott's administrative assistant and political wizard is Cheryl Ropolo. So I call Cheryl Ropolo, wake her up, and tell her this is the deal. And we've got to keep the judge from dismissing it. So, well, you better get your ass over there. So I go over to the court the next morning. The judge said, don't worry about that case, I'm going to dismiss it. And I said, no, you're not. If you dismiss this case, we have nothing to appeal. There's a constitutional issue here. He said, I would have to dismiss it anyway. I know that constable, and I wouldn't trust his testimony in a stop sign case. I said, fine. We'll set it up so you never have to hear him testify. And then I read the offense report. If you actually read the offense report, you would realize that this case was at least as complicated as the charge against the guy who was supposed to have violated the law by himself. This never happened. Well, how did it look like that? It looked like that because after making the arrest, the constable called the intake at the Harris County District Attorney's Office and said, what do I need to put in the paperwork to make this stick? Now, the officer didn't see anything going on. The assistant district attorney wasn't there. So a guy who doesn't know what he's talking about and a guy who doesn't have anything to talk about got together on the cell phone and they worked out this offense report. And if you read it, it's comical. And so I had that to deal with, and I'm looking at the offense report knowing that, oh, by the way, we entered a motion to quash and that gave us something to appeal, and then we started examining cases. I referred the case to a gay Houston lawyer that worked for Gerald Bernberg's office. Gerald Bernberg is my briefing attorney on my Supreme Court case. And that's why I sent the case over there. That lawyer called me the next day and said, I'm not a criminal lawyer. I don't know why he's out. I said, I know you're not a criminal. I wouldn't hire you to represent me on a traffic ticket. But you're in Gerald Bernberg's firm. And I know there are lawyers in your office that can handle this case. Well, I mean, it goes on like this for the next 5 years. He gets Lambda Legal involved. Lambda Legal comes down here and says, oh, well, you didn't tell us that there was a difference in the age between these defendants. So what? One's in his 50s, the other's in his 30s. Everybody's legal. What's the deal? Well, you didn't tell us that one was black and one was white. So what? I mean, you're Yankees. You're not supposed to be racially prejudiced. I would blow up. I heard that from a Southerner. So the case goes through the appellate courts. We never have a trial. From the JP's office, the next level for it to be appealed is up to county criminal court. So I walk into Sherman Ross's office and I said, you got the appeal from Judge Parrott's court. And he said, yeah, what do you mean to do with it? I said, pass it on. He said, you mean to rule against you? I said, absolutely. I got a constitutional issue here that I've got to keep alive. So from that court, we go to the District Court of Appeals, 3-judge panel. And we win. And I said, oh my God, that's the end of our appeal. So I secretly called Stephen Hotze, a Republican activist, and I tell him, Johnny Holmes is fixing to drop the appeal of that homosexual case. And Stephen Hotze takes it from there and screams and yells and pisses and moans and gets Johnny Holmes to appeal the decision to a full panel of the first, or I don't know whether it's the first or 14th court, but the District Court of Appeals. And in the meanwhile, Stephen Hotze goes to the media and attacks those judges and say, we're not going to vote for him in the next Republican primary. And so the rest of the judges look at that. They issue a turn down, or they grant the district attorney's opinion appeal without a written opinion, just pass it on to the Texas Court of Criminal Appeals, where the same thing happens, and that puts us in the Supreme Court of the United States. For the first time in my life, there is a case in the Supreme Court of the United States that will legalize homosexual conduct. First time. I've been a criminal ever since I was old enough to look at the back seam of a pair of Levi's with wishful thought. What that would mean that we would have to expand one of two principles. Equal justice under the law. In other words, the laws that regulate heterosexual activity cannot be exceeded when they regulate homosexual activity. Equal justice of the law. What you do for heterosexuals, you have to do with homosexuals. And the Texas law is a good one on that issue because Texas was a homosexual conduct code and had nothing to do with heterosexuals. So that's a good thought. But if we're really lucky, we might just push the envelope on the definition of privacy.
Privacy.
Well, if we didn't win on equal justice, and it was a long shot, but the real chance of a successful victory in the Lawrence case would be to expand the definition of privacy. Privacy is a tough issue. Constitutionally. The Constitution does not say you have a right to privacy. Your home is your castle. You have a right to be protected against unreasonable searches and seizures, which gives the hint that you have a right to privacy. But you'll not find the right to privacy articulated specifically in the Constitution anywhere. The right to privacy is one of those things that grows out of a distillation of independent and disparate rights guaranteed by the Constitution of the United States. And the bottom line is there's privacy. The understanding of privacy began in Connecticut in a case called Griswold versus Commonwealth's Attorney. Griswold were a heterosexual couple. And they decided that they didn't want to have any more children. But they couldn't buy in Connecticut condoms or other means of birth control because the Connecticut legislature had ruled that sale of such items, sale and promotion of such items, was unconstitutional on its face. Was illegal. So they brought a case, and that went all the way to the Supreme Court of the United States, and the Supreme Court said the marriage bed is a zone where there is absolute expectation of privacy, and what people do there is their business and not the government's business. and what they need to make those decisions, like condoms and other means of birth control, cannot be denied them on the basis of a perceived right to privacy. Well, that's the cornerstone of all pornographic law. You take Griswold plus the First Amendment and you create, you've got the right to look at what you want to, read what you want to, publish what you want to, as long as it's covered by the First Amendment, and you've got the right to have that privately, and you've got privacy rights. So Griswold is the beginning of a United States understanding of a constitutionally protected right to privacy. Well, along comes a famous abortion case, Roe v. Wade. Now, Roe v. Wade said, no. The right to privacy is definitely protected in the marriage bed. But it is also the right of a woman to control her body. Now all of a sudden marriage don't have anything to do with it. And we're still in the issue of birth control. So Roe v. Wade expanded privacy out of the narrow marriage bed zone. Well, along came an attempt to decriminalize homosexual law in the 80s, and the Supreme Court ruled 5-4 that the right to privacy did not include gay people's private sex life. Hardwick v. Bowers, a Georgia case, Michael Hardwick got caught having sex, and that went to the Supreme Court of the United States. And four of the justices said they've got the right, same right to privacy that heterosexuals have in the marriage bed and that a woman has all by herself. Except Sandra Day O'Connor asked a question during oral debate. She asked Hardwick's attorney, she said, if we approve this, we're expanding the zone of privacy from the bed itself or the individual to the bedroom door. And are we not, in effect, decriminalizing prostitution if money is not discussed until that door is closed? And the attorney for Hardwick said, yes, Justice O'Connor, we believe that is the meaning of this decision, and we will stand by that. Well, Justice O'Connor was ready to do anything except legalize prostitution. So she voted against it. Later, we would learn that Justice Powell had originally wanted to vote for that right, which would have gave us 5-4 win, 4-2 loss, including Justice O'Connor. But he thought, I don't know any homosexuals, when his favorite nephew and several of his staff were homosexual. And so he would later, after he was off the court, say, I wished I had voted the other way. O'Connor said in that opinion, if we were here on an equal justice argument, but the Georgia law applied equally to heterosexuals and homosexuals, so she upheld it. But she said, if we were looking at an equal justice argument, I would decide in favor of equal justice. Therefore, if heterosexuals can do it, homosexuals can too. So here come the Lawrence case. We argue it, and we wait. 3 days before Gay Pride Parade in Houston, Texas, at the end of June in 2003, the Supreme Court ruled 6-3 that the right to privacy
is expanded to include the right of gay men and lesbians in their intimacy. For the first time in my life, I woke up the next morning and I was not a criminal. In Texas, or in any jurisdiction where the Supreme Court of the United States holds sway. And of course, having done that, I realized that I had accomplished in the gay movement what I had originally set out to accomplish. My work was through. And so I announced that the following year, we would hold a town meeting at the end of which I would officially resign and retire from active involvement in gay politics. We held a town meeting called the Conference on the Future, and the community came up with a democratic process of deciding what they wanted to accomplish over the next decade. I didn't even have a vote. I chaired the meeting, listened to the resolutions, took down the votes, and when it was over, I handed my gavel to someone else, and that was my last act in gay and lesbian political leadership. Work was completed. I could then concentrate on freedom of speech issues.
Saving public access.
And I could then concentrate on criminal justice issues. I've got plenty to do and enough energy to do it.
God bless you.
And I left that movement in the best of hands. Most of the leadership in Houston's gay and lesbian transgendered movement are either women or transgendered. They come in a rainbow of colors, black, brown, Asian, Hispanic, white. They speak a confusion of languages, Farsi, Russian, several African-American dialects, a lot of Spanish, and those people can better represent this diverse community than this old white guy. But I served my purposes when it was my turn. I'm Ray Hill, and what you see behind me is the very center of my beloved Houston. What lies ahead is a corner of Montrose. That's where they know me as mayor. I'm the citizen provocateur in these environments, and I love them. They built this all around me.